So, this is the first of our debates on the Life's Big Questions element of what Cheltenham Together does. And the subject that we've chosen for this first of the debates is, why has terrorism become associated with Islam? So straight in there with a fairly controversial hot topic. This is how this is going to work. We want it to be as interactive as possible. So we really would like you to contribute to this discussion. So we've got a guest speaker who we'll introduce in a moment. This is not to say this is just simply a lecture by our guest speaker. It is for you to contribute your views, your challenges. Absolutely no problem in us having a really lively debate. It would be great if that were to happen. If you do want to contribute at any time during the evening, if you're sitting in these seats here, you've got microphones. All you do is just press the red button, the light comes on, you speak. Please remember, when you finish speaking, to press the red button again so the light goes off. If you've got too many red lights on at once, it makes a mess of the system. So if you could remember, turn it on and then turn it off when you've made your contribution. And the way in which the event operates, I think, has only one rule. And that rule is, please be respectful. Respectful of individuals, respectful of people's views, please be respectful of people's religions, perspectives, and so on. Absolutely nothing wrong in challenge, nothing wrong in robust discussion and debate, but please be respectful as part of that. So, to kick off this discussion, I would like to introduce our special guest, Abdullah Al-Andalusia. He is an international Muslim thinker, speaker and debater, and he's also the co-founder of the Muslim Debate Initiative. So, very warm welcome to you, Abdullah. You have a website, I think it's got your name with .com at the end.
Yeah, or thedebateinitiative.com.
Or thedebateinitiative.com. But I've been looking at it in preparation for this evening, and I have to say it's extremely interesting. I've learned a tremendous amount from it. So, worth following up with that. If the debate inspires your imagination, because I'm sure it will. So if I could hand over to Abdullah for about a 5-minute introduction, and then we'll look to contributions from others in the room.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of God, the most gracious, most merciful. I'd like to thank the organisers, and I'd like to thank you, the audience, for coming today, and organisers for arranging this interesting discussion. I would like to reiterate the sentiments of the organisers that this should be a no-holds-barred discussion. Ask anything you want, criticise anything you want, of course, while maintaining a generally accepted standards of decorum, which is obviously everyone, I'm sure, will. So this the topic is obviously quite controversial, but I actually like controversial topics. I would have actually preferred to have a special invited, like say, opposition speaker, to have a kind of who might specialise in this subject, to have a give you guys a real debate. But hopefully, I'm sure that you'll ask some very challenging questions or make some challenging points. But to just deal with this subject at hand, why has Islam become associated with terrorism? And I'd like to add a few words to that in the Western mind, because for Muslims, Islam isn't associated with terrorism. Islam is associated with peace, with good manners, with humanitarianism, with helping the poor, and being just and being merciful. In fact, the beginning of almost every chapter in the Quran starts in the name of God, the most gracious, most merciful. So one of the names of God in Islam is the most merciful. And so we don't, as Muslims, associate Islam with terrorism. But why has it been associated? Well, for Muslims, we probably view people who are terrorists much like people, Americans would view Timothy McVeigh, or Christians would view the Westboro Baptist Church, which, if any of you don't know who they are, they like to go outside, protest outside the funerals of dead American soldiers with placards saying God hates fags and cause a stir. Now, obviously, Christians in America know that they don't represent Christianity. Why? Well, because Christians are the majority and they recognize who the minority is amongst them. Whereas people who are not Christian, obviously in America, also can see that the majority of society obviously view it as a fringe. But when a religious group is a minority in a country, it becomes difficult for the majority to know what's fringe or not fringe within that minority. And this brings us to really answering the question, how comes these minorities of people who are, let's say, very controversial, how comes they're so loud? Well, it's not that their voice is actually louder than anyone else. They are given a platform. And who gives them the biggest platform of them all? It's the media. It was almost a case where the Daily Mail, The Sun, and many news channels would love to invite such individuals, and they would put their face on the front cover, and they would describe them as a British imam, or an Islamic scholar, which Muslims wouldn't recognize, or a cleric, which again Muslims don't recognize, but would portray that to the British public, and the British public, obviously, the majority don't know the internal dynamics in the Muslim community, and so unbeknownst to them, they believe this person is a prominent figure in the Muslim community. And of course, sensation sells, and that's the problem. I was once asked in a debate with a member of the BNP, I was questioned, how come we don't hear more Muslims condemning terrorism? Well, firstly, I'd argue it's like why we don't hear many Quakers condemning terrorism. As far as Muslims are concerned, Islam prohibits killing innocent civilians, killing people, wanton destruction. So it's a given that Islam prohibits it. Why do we have to keep reiterating it? Like it's somehow we're guilty if we don't. Secondly, is there actually are hundreds of thousands of Muslim scholars, notables, public speakers who've participated in thousands of events, issued thousands of declarations, issued thousands of legal declarations, or what we call fatwas. Fatwas isn't a death sentence, it's just a legal declaration. Against terrorism, against condemning these groups, but you don't hear it because it's not newsworthy. It's not sensationalist enough. You won't hear the BNP do it, but I asked that BNP guy, have you Google searched it? Just Google search Muslims condemning terrorism. And I ask all of you to do the same, and you'll find thousands upon thousands of results of it. So the problem is, I suppose this brings us back to this philosophical question, obviously if a branch falls in the forest and no one's around to hear it, did it really happen? If Muslims are condemning terrorism by the thousands, are highest of highest notables doing so, but the media aren't covering it, then unfortunately the media have rendered it like it never happened, because they have the power to dictate what you see and what you hear. Now, I'm just going to wrap it up before to kind of open up to the discussions. What are the motivations of these terror groups, and how prolific is terrorism in the Muslim world? Well, it really isn't prolific in the Muslim world. And of course, the explanations of the terrorism is always going to be actually social political factors. In the 70s, it was communists. If you go into the 1900s, it was Catholics. These were all viewed as the people who produced terrorism, or the most terrorism, or responsible for terrorism, or anarchist violence, as it used to be called back then. And even the suffragettes, actually, who were different from the suffragists. Suffragists were the peaceful movement for women's rights. Suffragettes were known for arson and detonating bombs and so on and so forth. So violence, unfortunately, is a human phenomena that doesn't respect any particular religion, doesn't emerge from any particular religion or political ideology, and unfortunately has been used by all political ideologies. More so than religions. People always think that religion is the biggest cause of terrorism. Actually, it's actually political ideology. In South America, you had the Nicaraguan Contras, funded by the CIA, of course, death squads in Nicaragua, and so on and so forth, which were terrorist groups. But they weren't viewed as too harshly because they were on, quote-unquote, the side of the free world against those nasty communists. And again, we see the same situation throughout the world. In Africa, there are many groups and militias which can be good or bad depending on which ideological side you're on during the 20th century. In 60s, 70s, and 80s, there was loads of airplane hijackings, and obviously there was bombs and killings. There was a guy called Luis Posales, if I remember his name correctly, who was an anti-Cuban terrorist. He blew up an airliner, Cuban airliner, killing innocent Cuban civilians. Where is he now? Well, he's relaxing and enjoying his pension in the United States. And the United States resisted the demand to extradite him for terrorism because he was, in essence, working for the CIA at the time. So the cause of terrorism is usually social, political circumstances. And I'll end with actually kind of showing how the terrorists themselves explain. So when we see, there was an Al Jazeera interview with Osama bin Laden. And the Al Jazeera interview was in 2003 and asked him, in Islam, it's recognized that, and the Prophet Muhammad himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, prohibited targeting civilians in warfare. And Osama bin Laden said, you're right, that is true. And the Prophet Muhammad did do this. But Osama bin Laden retorted, but that prohibition isn't set in stone, he said. And that in the modern war context, if the enemy bomb your people, you should respond in like manner to dissuade them from bombing your people. So Osama bin Laden viewed it as a defensive kind of measure in order to a retaliation. And what he cites in his literature isn't the Prophet Muhammad, isn't early Islamic history or some classical Islamic fatwas which don't exist. There is no fatwa that allows terrorism. Instead, he cites strategic bombing of World War II Germany, the firebombing of Dresden, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. He cites American military history and British military history as his model for imitation. He said if it's good enough for them to do it, then it should be good enough for me to do it. And the response from Muslim scholars, from Muslims themselves, is that he is going against Islam. He is not a fundamentalist in that sense, because a fundamentalist would follow the fundamentals of Islam. He is adopting an altogether modern approach, which is antithetical to Islam. And he cites his grievance, not that the West are living in freedom or are enjoying some kind of liberty, and that's why he's just jealous, or they must force convert the infidel to Islam. That's not what he cites. His argument has been, and many counter-terrorism experts in the CIA, like Michael Schur, and the MI5 have made the same, and MI6 have made the same point, which the government, the American and British government, seem to be deaf to, which is, they never said that they hate your way of life, that's why they're attacking you. They have grievances with US support of Israel, US support of tyrannical dictators. Now, whether you agree with that or not, these policies, these foreign policies, there is no justification for terrorism whatsoever. No matter whether it's a just cause or an unjust cause, there is absolutely no justification. And Osama bin Laden should be condemned from the first instance for going against not only the Islamic edicts, but doing vile actions which cause revulsion in all human beings who have a heart for their fellow people. So I would say that's my kind of 5 minutes or so up, and I welcome any frank, robust questions from you.
Thank you very much. Right, well, a few statements there. So, would you like to make a contribution?
Yes, sir. Is it not the case that there are Quranic texts which reflect a period when Muhammad himself was facing resistance, which could be used and quoted as getting back into terrorism?
Okay, this is... there is actually no Quranic text, even cited by the terrorists themselves, that is used to support terrorism. The closest text they use and twist is they use a text that says, "Fight them as they fight those who fight you, and in the same manner as they, or fight them as they fight you." Now he tried to say, "Well, this means that we can now imitate British military history, American military history, and retaliate in the same, we're using the same tactics that they use against." Some Muslim countries and peoples. But the continuation of that verse says, but do not transgress the limits of God. And so they seem to cut out that bit at the end. So there's no text in the Quran that says kill infidels and force convert them to Islam. There's no text, and they don't cite those texts at all. They tried to, in a way, cite a kind of a modernist half interpretation of a text. And I use the word modernist not in the positive sense. As a Muslim who follows, you say, the fundamentals of Islam, I view modernism within Islamic discourses as something that's not from the Islamic traditions. But Osama bin Laden is not following the fundamentals of Islam, and neither have they put any justifications from the Quran other than a verse that they say allows them to imitate the West, which obviously we contest.
Okay,
thank
you. Any other
press this button? I know that there is an ayah in the Quran, which is decontextualized. People use the one where they say, oh, kill them wherever you find them. But they don't understand the meaning behind that ayat. That ayat was set because the Quran was revealed over a period of 23 years. So it's got a lot of history. There's a lot of history in it. And that was set at a particular period of time. And it was a time when the Muslims, so when they first heard about Islam, they were persecuted by the the pagan Arabs. They were tortured, killed, boycotted, their businesses were boycotted, so they had to go to Medina. That was the safest thing for them to do. And basically what happened is these people were, like, obviously troublemakers. They were, you know, they were torturing Muslims. And in Islam, you have the right to defend yourself against oppression. You can fight against oppression. There's nothing wrong with that. So they were instructed to kill the troublemakers, not the ones that were, like, living in peace with the Muslims, the ones that were torturing and killing Muslims. So a lot of people, they seem to use the ayah, and they don't understand the meaning behind it. But if they did research, they would realize that it's a particular time, you know? Like, for example, Winston Churchill, he said his famous speech, we'll kill them on the beaches and this. Doesn't necessarily mean we do it now. That was a time when we were at war with Germany. So it's just decontextualized, basically.
Is it, Sarah, a little bit like the concept of a just war in Christianity? Does that sound similar?
There's a whole history of development of the doctrine of the just war. But I think this is a resort to the particular Quranic text at a point, as you were saying, when Muhammad was facing opposition and the way of dealing with the opposition. Right? So I think you've got to see things in context, like you say.
If I might just quickly respond, the verse doesn't say kill all disbelievers or what have you. The actual verse is referring to, and it says, I mean, you don't even to look at it into historical context, just if you're reading the verses preceding and after, it's referring to these hostile Arab pagan tribes at the time of the Prophet Muhammad. It mentions them, and it says that when the months of the ceasefire has passed, and then basically you use military stratagems to fight their military. But then it says that those basically who are peaceful, then you encounter obviously anyone who doesn't fight, is not fighting from these pagans, then escort them to a place of safety. Yeah, that's what it says following from that particular verse. So we don't need to even use historical context. The verse itself is quite clear who it's talking about, and it's saying that it's limiting it to those who are fighting at the end of a ceasefire agreement. But even in that situation, even that verse, the terrorist organizations have never cited that verse because it's so clear. They try mental gymnastics with the verse I cited earlier on. That's the verse they mostly use. Other verses they use are very general verses about defending yourself, fighting for justice, very general exhortations for those things to support their cause. But specifically for terrorism, that is the only verse they use, which is fight them as they fight you. And again, they cut off the next verse so as not to deal with it.
Thank you very much.
Yes, just building up on what was said, I completely agree that it's taken out of context. And also the fact that, like, when I read that, it reminds me of that movie, 300, if you've seen it, where, you know, he stands and it's war talk. It's a handful of people fighting a huge army who are already being persecuted. And so, obviously, they're not going to say, come and kill us. It's going to be, stand up, you can fight, and all of that. And there are certain words which might seem strong, quite strongly worded, but I think that comes down to, which are quite often quoted in various well-known newspapers as well, actually. And in my limited knowledge, I think it's the fact that Arabic is a very complex language, and there are lots and lots of meanings of the same word. For example, the word zerb can mean smite at their necks and things like that, as I've read in newspapers. So I think a deeper understanding of the language and the context, of course, is warranted, definitely. And also the point made about the media. Yes, growing up, I have seen, I remember images of, you know, George Bush Sr. Talking about the Mujahideen, the word jihad, everybody's familiar with that. So Mujahid is somebody who carries out that jihad. And that was being used for you know, the same people we know as the Taliban now. But at the time, they were fighting the Red Army. So I think it's also, media has a huge responsibility in bringing out you know, the context of everything, whether it's an ayah, whether it's a situation, a political situation. So I think a little more responsibility would go a long way.
Can I, this would be very unfair, possibly, but you're going to put your hand up anyway.
I was.
Manny here is from the BBC, so
yes.
he might respond to some of the comments about the media.
Well, I think, no, to a certain extent, you're probably right, because the BBC and the ITV and Channel 4, they all take a particular angle, and they take it from Western eyes, and sometimes it can be misunderstood by non-Western people. But what I was going to talk about is that I know a lot of Muslim people, and some of my best friends are Muslims, and as individuals, everyone is wonderful, lovely, no problem. But Islam has a history of violence. Like the priest just said, that right from Prophet Muhammad's time, there's fighting. And that's why he when he went to Medina, he was coming back to Mecca, and he's fighting all those people living in Mecca. He killed a lot of Christians, he killed a lot of Arabs. But then, also, look at what happened to the Mughals. When they came over to India, they converted a lot of Sikhs, or Hindus, and other religions to Islam, the Muslims, by killing them. If they didn't actually convert, they were killed. Then look at, all right, I know you want to answer, but I'll give you a chance in a second. But then you look, when you look at Iran and Iraq, they're always fighting, killing Muslims. There's violence. When you look at Kuwait and Iraq, when they started, violence is violence now. You look at Palestinians, they were bombing. I know the Israelis were attacking them, but they're bombing other people. So Islam is just full of violence right from the very first start.
I was going to ask you why you invited someone like Anjem Choudhry onto your platform, but I think you've answered that now. Basically, okay, well, firstly, let's kind of take the word violence. So if someone breaks into your house and is trying to kill you, and you basically defend yourself by killing them, obviously the court's not going to punish you for that if it's self-defense. But could someone condemn you, say, oh, look, you used violence to defend yourself? The thing is this, violence can be used to defend the weak, the poor, the oppressed, or it can be used to take away people's property, to kill innocents, and so on and so forth. The Western tradition and the Christian traditions have, obviously, an understanding of just war theory, the idea of defensive war, or the war to defend those who are being oppressed. So proactive wars to defend people being oppressed has been used, unfortunately, to educate the world to be civilized by colonialization, which coincidentally happens to also be resource-rich areas and land. But the situation is that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, firstly, never actually fought any wars with any Christians during his time. There was no any battles, so I don't know where you got this idea of Christians being killed. And secondly, some of the pagan Arab tribes around him were extremely hostile to Muslims, to the point of torturing Muslims to death, putting boulders on Muslims. One of the first martyrs for Islam was a woman, Sumaya, who was speared to death through her belly. So this was the kind of hostility they were experiencing. And they responded, but they didn't respond in the manner that would kill civilians or massacre those who are innocent. They responded militarily to those who were fighting militarily and not to civilians, whereas the opponents didn't really make that decision, that discrimination rather, and so on. So I would argue against that. But as I said, and this is a question that I think you really should actually answer, is why the BBC felt compelled to invite people like Anjem Choudhry, which effectively propped up his career for 15 years. Everyone complained about why isn't he in prison? That's not the real question to ask. The question is, why is he constantly being given platforms by the media, despite the fact that he has, well, let's just put it this way, any Muslim here could arrange a wedding reception with more guests than he has supporters in his group, and yet he was constantly invited as a British imam on the BBC. Can you answer that question, sir?
Well, I'm not going to answer that, but if you can answer my question first, though. Which is, what about this violence in India, Mughals?
Okay, well,
what about these Shias and Sunnis? As soon as Prophet Muhammad died, wasn't there a big fight in the Sunnis and Shias?
There was no...
There was violence, wasn't there?
Well, there was no, let's say, technically Sunnis and Shias in the modern sense of the word back then.
Well,
but,
even in the old sense.
But let's put it this. Before Britain and the Sykes-Picot agreement in the Middle East, Let me explain. Iraqi Shias were living peacefully and protected under a Sunni Ottoman caliph. Their shrines were maintained and kept, obviously, in good nick by a Sunni Ottoman caliphate. There was no sectarian fighting before Britain came and civilized the region into its current patchwork mosaic of bickering, secular, tyrannical tyrants. So I would say that's my response. As for India, India's a bit of it's a very long history of Muslim rule in India. And obviously, while Mughals and some of their policies were not necessarily the best to the people there, but again, the Hindu Maharatas, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, and the Sikh kingdom as well, there was a lot of bad things occurring on all sides. But the Mughals weren't the first Muslims to come into India. The first Muslims coming to India actually didn't force convert people into Hinduism. The very fact that you have the vast majority of people from the Indian subcontinent are Hindu is the fact that Muslims didn't force convert them to Islam. Whereas people in South America and the Philippines became Catholic, not necessarily out of choice. And they didn't, and their religions, their old religions, no longer exist. So if the Muslims had a policy of systematically forcing Hindus to become Muslim, then you wouldn't see any Hindus there anymore. Like you can't see any, pagan South Americans anymore or pagan Filipinos anymore. So I would say that that's not you're kind of papering over history there with just looking at, just trying to kind of, well, even not entirely historically accurate, the kind of tolerance that was actually exhibited under the rule, even by the Mughal, different Mughal dynasties. So I'd say that we can always nitpick from history any bad particular instances that happened. But if you look at, I'm asking, look at what was the norm in India. The norm was tolerance. The norm was convivency between the religions.
I think we've got a speaker over here. If you wouldn't mind turning your microphone off, ma'am.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. Thank you, Chair. Allowed me to speak. I thought it was going to be a one-man show with Manny Massive in the studio. Hi, Manny. I just want to pick up on just one thing. That I'd like to thank, basically, first of all, the organisers of the Cheltenham Together Group for organising this. Mr. Chair, they over there touched on media, and we're having such a lovely debate, but there's no media critics here, so I can get to report it positively. But Brother Abdullah already answered there to my, I was going to rebut it back to Manny about conflicts. There's always been conflicts in faith and religion throughout time. And it doesn't mean to say that Islam, where people read the Quran and ayahs twist the words to their own needs, it always benefits the weapon makers, the financials, and institutes such as that. So I think we need to keep an open mind. We're not here for a history lesson, but I'm not a learned person, but there are some learned people here who can be as that. And I just think it's a shame that we've got this group here, but we haven't got any media coverage.
They were invited, I think.
Okay.
can I ask a question? Because it's something that Manny touched on. But to westernise, the Islamic world seems quite divided. The Sunnis and the Shias, and various sects within each of those groups. Would most Muslims say the situation is as you say it, that is that terrorism is completely outlawed by the Quran? Or are there sects who actually believe that that's wrong and that actually the Quran does justify terrorism? Because I'm assuming that some people in Islamic State, for example, would not subscribe to the views that you've subscribed to.
Well, I could say quite confidently that there exists no school of thought, no sect or denomination that holds a different opinion on the issue of the prohibition against the Islamic prohibition against targeting civilians in warfare, and hence there's no one for me to debate on that matter, because there is no intellectual position on the issue, and no one actually holds that position. What you'll find with these particular groups is that they have already made a decision to undertake certain activities. ISIS, I don't even call them Islamic State, ISIS, who are headed by Iraqi Ba'athists, former Saddam Hussein officers, intelligence officers, really repeat the same policies that he did. The Middle East can seem very confusing to many here. But in the Middle East, secular dictators, it's not above, it's not above them to adopt the garb of Islam when it suits them and to use it for their advantage. So, for example, President Sisi of Egypt, who's viewed as a secular leader and who has normalized relations with the West, let's say obtained, quote unquote, a fatwa from one of the head clerics of Al-Azhar, the Islamic institution in Egypt, that allowed his soldiers to open fire on peaceful protesters. And I mean, it's not, there's no text for it, but he just got the cleric to say, these people are all rebels, and so it's like they're fighting, so you can open fire on them. And no one talks about that. No one says, oh, Sisi has a different opinion about Islam, or he has a follow different school of thought. No, he doesn't. He's a secular dictator. He doesn't really care. He doesn't actually have any particular school of thought, per se. Saddam Hussein, just like his later children, shall I say, ISIS, he put Allah's name on the Iraqi flag. Didn't used to be there before. He said that he was a descendant of the Prophet Muhammad. Obviously, we couldn't verify that. No one could verify. He went to the Hajj. He started being filmed praying, pretending he's religious to shore up his regime to get support from the Iraqi people against the coming invasions. And of course, he'd even named his operations that massacred Kurds and others after surahs of the Quran, which is outrageous. But we shouldn't be surprised then that his children, the former Saddam Hussein, obviously Saddam Hussein's officers, are following the exact same rule book which every secular dictator does in the Middle East, which is adopt the garb of Islam when you need to show up for support, because the people are very religious in the Muslim world, and that is leveraged or used by these dictators to get what they want. And ISIS are no different. ISIS have done exactly the same thing that Saddam Hussein does, that Sisi does. But the way that the media have described it, unfortunately, I say that the biggest proponents of arguing that ISIS are Islamic are media and many neoconservative pundits and even conservative pundits who think, yeah, ISIS, they're Islamic, and you're doing their job for them because they want to portray themselves as Islamic, but they have never advanced an argument from Islam, from classical Islam, that allows terrorism. Just one small example, they burnt a Jordanian pilot alive. And any Muslim can tell you that the Prophet Muhammad explicitly prohibited the use of fire, even when fighting military opponents, because fire is believed to be the punishment reserved only for God. And yet ISIS have no qualms about using the most brutal methods that their father Saddam Hussein would also use, because that's where they come from. They are former Ba'athists. Newspapers came out with captured ISIS documents showing that the individuals behind it were former Saddam Hussein intelligence officers and so on and so forth. And yet we still think that ISIS are Islamic, or they are somehow different from any of the secular regimes. And example, Bashar al-Assad, who's fighting obviously against his opposition rebels, he has Hezbollah, a religious group, fighting alongside him, and he portrays his conflict in religious terms. But the media don't obviously portray Bashar al-Assad doing this, so you don't see it. But he's actually, again, leveraging religion to shore up his regime against those he fights. So it might be confusing for those outside the Middle East, but the Middle East is a very religious, obviously, area. So anyone that wants to get anything done or to get support for themselves has to use religious terminology or mental gymnastics, interpretations that involve mental gymnastics in order to get any kind of support there. And so, but you don't realize this. And this is the problem, is that you don't see what's happening internally. You just see what's being portrayed by the media, and it gives you a wrong perception.
Thank you very much. I think there's a question. Yes.
I understand that it would be wrong to associate terrorism with Islam, but will it be fair to say to associate it with Muslims? Because what we see, where it's happening,
is
amongst Muslim communities.
Is that a question to me, or was it just
general?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'll tell you this. Right now, the current conflicts in the world, the most obviously, the biggest conflagrations are obviously happening in the Middle East. But why is everyone so forgetful about just even recent history? I mean, if I went back in a time machine 20 years ago, you think in Europe, it's Irish people seem to be most associated with terrorism. Obviously, there's nothing about Irish people that makes them predisposed to terrorism, But because of the social political factors then, and of course if you want to go back a bit more, any particular conflagration, South America was a hotbed of terrorism due to the Cold War fault lines which were drawn through the middle of that continent. So it depends where you want to set your amnesia from, who you associate terrorism with. The Middle East had Arab Springs, it suffered the war on terror, invasions which destabilized Afghanistan, Iraq, obviously Libya was destabilized too with the Arab Spring. And of course you're going to have these issues. Likewise, an example, let's say tomorrow Russia invades England, God forbid, and takes and installs a puppet government. There's going to be complete instability in UK. You're going to see a lot of violence from vigilante groups, militia groups that rise up, because when you have a destabilized regime, that's what happens. So obviously these are issues that obviously we all want to see resolved, but we shouldn't be so myopic when we're looking at history. If you see the bigger scheme of things, the best argument you could say is that humans have been associated with terrorism, and that are the real perpetrators.
The question should be why they're doing it, not why it's associated with them.
Well, it's your question on that point.
Well, I don't really understand what you mean.
The question arises then that why they are committing these acts of terrorism. Why are they doing it?
Because, first of all, we're human beings, okay? I'm not condoning that going around killing people is correct, but I'm sorry, but it's not just what really annoys me is the British press or any Western newspaper, if a Pakistani man or something, they'll say, Pakistani Muslim does such and such, you know? Why are they putting their ethnicity and their religion as the primary reason for them committing the offence? But if we look at Jimmy Savile, was his religion or his ethnicity mentioned? It wasn't. So it seems like double standards there. I can say that I'm not a Muslim myself, but I can say Islam's perfect, but Muslims aren't. And I'm not justifying going around killing people, but they're just bad people. You can't tarnish every single Muslim with the same brush. Just because someone goes and kills someone doesn't mean every single Muslim is a terrorist. You know, that, in my opinion, is a contradiction. I mean, I've lived in Saudi Arabia for 7 years of my life, and I have nothing but the great hospitality in their manners are outstanding and excellent. So it infuriates me that, you know, Muslims are persecuted, demonized, when Islam is a beautiful religion. So, and the sanctity that Islam gives on human life is immense. For example, there is a story about a woman, she had a cat, and she used to torment the cat, and she starved the cat to death, and basically Allah punished her. Because if the sanctity of the life on the animal is, you know, if Allah does that, imagine the sanctity of human life. So Islam honours family, wealth, dignity and respect of every individual in society. And if we're opening this debate, we should really go to the religious sources. And can I please read an ayat out, please, from the Quran? Which can just basically contradict...
We answer the question first, though.
Well, I've answered his question. I've answered his question. He said to me, why are Muslims doing it?
Yeah.
Well, because they're bad. The ones that are doing it are bad.
Yeah.
And you can just say, may Allah guide them. That's all you can say.
Just taking it a little bit wider, what seems to be being said, and you're talking, I know, about Islam specifically, but it could be said that there are no bad religions, there are just bad people. Is that pretty much...
They're not following their religion.
Yeah.
And they need to repent, because Allah's just, but he's also merciful.
Possibly we could come back to you with your quotation, but we've got a gentleman over there. Sir, would you like to come forward to this microphone?
Actually, there are just two things I wanted to say that came from your opening statement. First, being mercy. And I think it's very dangerous in the 21st century to rely on a word like mercy. And I wondered if you might just take a moment to define mercy to us.
Well, mercy, from the, obviously the Islamic perspective of that word, is when you give someone less than they deserve of punishment. So if they're due some kind of punishment, you don't give them that punishment. You choose not to give them that punishment, what they deserve. Or alternatively, you show compassion. So you give them something that you don't have to, they don't necessarily can take from you, but you give it to them, what something they need or something that helps them.
So it's an ideology. Because if it's an ideology, there's not very much different with the National Socialist ideology. The compassion for those who are disabled is to finish them off pretty quickly and to relieve the burden on society. And so you see, mercy is a very dangerous word, and not a word that I would want to use to describe my principles. The second thing, which I thought was interesting that you said about, was that the Quran says that the killing of innocent people is prohibited. And the lady behind you spoke about the dignity of human life. So I wondered whether either of you might like to explain to me how an innocent person can be thrown off a roof for being homosexual, and where the dignity in respecting that life is, because I struggle to see it.
Okay, well, your first point, I'll say I don't see the connection between mercy and Nazis. So I don't see.
Mercy, compassion. Mercy as a word for you means one thing, for the lady over there means something else potentially. So we must be very careful when we decide to use words and how we apply them, because we can apply them to our own ideologies, and our different ideologies can end up being quite dangerous.
I would say that unlike the ideas that arose out of the Western Enlightenment, of which National Socialism or Fascism were one of them, Islam has very specific definitions of how you discharge mercy. So smiling at people is considered to be a charity, act of mercy. Helping people, helping the poor, is an act of mercy. It's defined not only to show mercy, but also a practical method of how you discharge that. So there's no clouded understanding of it amongst the Muslims, because Islam is pretty thorough in dealing with giving guidance on how you manifest. It doesn't just say, be merciful and you can commit euthanasia on people who are mentally disabled or so on. Like, I might add, Winston Churchill argued that imbeciles and those who have certain disabilities should be euthanized to protect or prevented from reproducing, to protect the British gene pool, for example. So I know, but it's a bit of a jump. If you were to say to me, point to me anything in Islam specifically that you say resembles Nazis, I would accept that. But just to say that because Islam believes in mercy, it will now be Nazism, I think it's a bridge too far, logically speaking. As for...
It's not a bridge too far if you listen rather than just hear what you want to. I'm not talking about divide between Islam, Christianity, Judaism, atheism, scientists. What I'm talking about is when you apply a word to an ideology that you choose to believe. It means, for you, there's no clouding for Muslims of what mercy means. For people who went along with National Socialism, there is no clouding of what it means. If you ask every single Catholic nun, there will be no clouding of what mercy means to them. But to each individual, it means something slightly different. And so we must be very careful that we don't only decide to believe in our own version of what that word is, because it's isolating, it's dangerous, and it means that all we do is entrench ourselves in our own little ghettos rather than communicating with each other, which is what I thought the point of the evening was.
Well, but what you're arguing is really the destruction of language, because if we can't use words for fear that people might understand the words differently, then why speak at all? Justice can mean just as much be misused as any other word can. Love can be misused as any other word can. So that's why I'm saying that if you'd like to point to something specific in how Islam defines mercy, I could then respond to that. But your second question, I think, is more pertinent. I think would be something that I think people should understand the Islamic position. I'm going to be very forthright on this matter and say that Islam doesn't have any punishment for homosexuals. There is no punishment in no text, no Quranic text, no hadith. Hadith is the tradition of the Prophet Muhammad. No text that says the homosexual must be punished. Why is that? It's because in Islam, we have no word to discriminate people based on sexual taxonomy or sexual proclivity. There is no discrimination on. We don't define you are the heterosexual, you are the bisexual, you're the asexual, you're the homosexual. There is no even words to classify people in these different categories, which I think is a problem. Also pointed out by sexual psychologist Kinsey in 20th century, that it's even wrong to use the word these kinds of words in the first place, because human sexuality is more on a sliding scale or continuum, not pigeonholed labels, but that's a different discussion. You'll find the word homosexual was invented by, I think, a German guy in the late 19th century, and then it became in use, and then the discrimination of people who were labeled with that word began. Whereas in Islam, actually, even much like the Bible, there is actually no word for homosexual. And if you're inquiring, maybe your rebuttal to that might be, okay, then what about people then who, let's say, engage in same-sex intercourse? What, are they punished? Well, firstly, same-sex intercourse, well, the political aspect of the Sharia is application of Sharia law or Islamic law, doesn't interfere with what you do in the privacy of your own home. So whatever you do in the privacy of your own home, much like, to an extent, British law as well, it doesn't concern itself what you do in the privacy of your own home. Outside, if someone was to literally have intercourse in public of any kind, heterosexual or what have you, that is prohibited under public decency laws, which I do believe also exist in the UK as well. But there is no punishment for homosexuals. But I'll tell you this, in Muslim discourse, I will concede, in Muslim discourse in the modern Middle East, they do use the word homosexual. And do you know where they learnt it from? Do you know where Muslims learnt the word homosexual, or who they learnt it from? Have a wild guess. Okay, well, I said there is no justification for throwing people off buildings based on their sexual proclivities. I thought that question was answered. The people who taught the Muslim world how to categorize people and even to discriminate people was the British Empire. And that's widely known. Even, for example, in Kenya, where they didn't even have any taboo on same-sex practice until British came, they were Christianized. And then they were taught what it means to be a Christian is the Victorian understanding of it. And then they started to discriminate and have laws against people who are homosexual. So the point is that, unfortunately, the Muslims have been a very good student of Victorian British values, but not necessarily Islamic values that predate that don't have that discrimination in the first place. So to answer your question very clearly, there is no punishment for homosexuals.
Can I ask a question? Just based on this idea of sort of law, Sharia law.
Sure.
It seems that Sharia law permits, in fact requires, that a thief should have their hand cut off at some point, or that people who are adulterous might be stoned. Is that right, or have I misunderstood?
Well, I mean, okay. Technically, the topic today is terrorism, and these are obviously other areas, but it's fine. Obviously, we should ask any questions that come to mind. And what most people don't understand is some of the laws in Islam obviously have biblical resonances, but the way they're constructed, it's for deterrence. They're too impractical to actually apply. What I mean by that is, for example, there is a punishment in classical understanding of Islamic law, which is that people who have been found guilty of committing adultery obviously are punished by stoning to death, similar to the biblical law. That exists in classical Islamic thinking. However, the burden of proof requires four witnesses to the fact, and not just four witnesses, but four witnesses of which, how do I best describe this? Let's just say they see everything to the point that there is absolutely no doubt. So it's not just two people who happen to be naked next to each other, but that there was no doubt there was actual intercourse, full intercourse occurred, which is virtually impossible to prove. And the reason why it's been constructed in that way is because its main utility is a deterrence. And it really applies actually to Muslims, not to... Sharia in an Islamic government doesn't apply to non-Muslims. I have to make that very clear. Even in, I think in Saudi Arabia, the compounds were exempt. So non-Muslim expats are not under Saudi law, although I would contest some of Saudi law is not necessarily Islamic. The function of that particular understanding of the law is actually mostly as a deterrent, because it cannot be practically applied at all. It's almost like if I wanted to make a law that would capture punish every adulterer, I could make a better law that would capture much more people. But that law, the burden proof is so insanely high, it seems like it's just a symbolic law to deter people. from, and of course anyone who reads the Old Testament would see it's no different to Jewish halakha law, and that may be some interpretations of law by Christians over the centuries, but of course with different burdens of proof perhaps. As for the issue of theft, again I would say it's in the same kind of category as deterrence, because what most people don't realize is there are seven criteria that have to be satisfied before that punishment can be discharged. One of them is that the person is not poor. If a person is poor and commits theft, they cannot be punished in Islamic law. It's actually more, that would be a shame on the state, shame on the community for allowing this poor person to be forced to steal because they were poor. They have to steal over an amount of a particular amount of gold. They have to steal from a secure location. So really, the only people who would actually be affected by that are criminal gangs like, you know, Ocean's 11 with George Clooney. Not George Clooney, but the the character he played in Ocean's 11. Maybe those people should have cause for fear, those who are career criminals who do it for luxury and as a sport. But not most people who do it for more mundane or prosaic reasons. So again, it's more deterrence.
I hadn't understood that. Yes, sir.
Did it look this way? You're looking there.
I'm very sorry. I will take this gentleman. Adam, you've had a couple of goes, so if so, you would like to go and then look at
it. I'd like to add to what Brother Abdullah said about the punishment for adultery. He mentioned four people seeing actual penetration. Something which might have slipped his mind, which actually is really important, is the fact that these can't be any four people you pick up off the street. Each one of these four people have to have an entire history, never to have not lied, even been accused of lying in a court before. So if I was wrongly accused of lying in an Islamic court, and I were to then stand up in a court and say, you know what, myself and three upright members of this community who have never committed a wrong in their life, equivalent to today, would be no parking fines, nothing. No speeding tickets, nothing. Completely clean slate. And then I'm the fourth person, but I've been accused of lying somewhere. The judge will go, you know what, get them out of here. It doesn't stand up. And I want to finish with one thing where, you know, for all these punishments and capital punishments you mentioned, number one, capital punishment also exists today. Okay? It exists in different countries. You don't agree with it in this country, fine. It exists in America on a wider scale. And number two is the fact that if you look, remember, as Muslims, our role model is the Messenger, peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In his life, he never ever punished anybody for committing the act of adultery if they were caught. In fact, a woman came to him and a woman said, oh Prophet, I have committed the act of adultery. And the Prophet turned his face away. He said, I don't want to hear it. Maybe it was just kissing. Go away. And she came back again and he said, you know what, no, maybe you were drunk. And then he asked the companions, she went to the companions, his companion said, look, smell my breath, I'm not drunk. Then she came again and he said, no, maybe it was a hug, it was nothing. Go and repent on your own. I don't want to punish you. Then she came back a fourth time. So she confessed, not once, not twice, not three times. She confessed four times. And only then the messenger said, okay, she came to me. This is the fourth time she's come. Now you can go through with the punishment. Never in my understanding of Islamic law has a person been punished through conviction of a crime like this, except that it was through confession. Because, like he said, because it is aimed to be a deterrent, where everybody is scared. Now, I'll give an example where if we might think of a scenario where four people can come together. Think of one example where four people come together and four people can see a couple have penetration outside of wedlock whilst each of them are married. The only scenario it happens in today is the porn industry. Each person who watches it, meaning not on camera, live, when it's going on, each person's witness will not stand up. Each person's testimony will have no value in Islamic law. Even though they've seen it, and there's four, there's 10 of them. But Islamic law will say, it doesn't matter if there's 100 of you. None of you are bright enough to stand up in this square and accuse anybody of anything else.
I think my question took a bit off the subject, didn't it? Sir.
Thank you. I'd like to change the tone of the debate. The problem tonight is that we don't have any radical Muslim adherents here. Because what we are listening to are people who actually we believe in the same thing. Because fundamentally, what you said about Islam being so, the teachings of Islam being so pure, you can say that about Christianity, you can say that about Hebrewism. It's the practice of some of these teachings that's causing the problems. And where does the problem come from? It's from the fundamentalist people who take the teaching and turn it to their own belief. Now, if we talk about the history and try and justify some of the things that are happening today through history, then I think we miss the point. Basically because every major religion has a role in society to carry forward an ever-advancing civilization, not to justify or to defend the violence of the fundamentalists. Basically, I think that the problem with us in trying to defend it is that we're just falling into the trap of an eye for an eye. So Winston Churchill said this, the Christians did this, therefore it justifies some of the actions today. I really believe that that kind of debate should be put aside and look at the reasons why people are so easily swayed by fundamentalist practitioners of religions. Why do I understand? If I look at, I don't want to insult anybody. There are different peoples in the world with different emotional makeup. Why is it that certain parts of the world will easily swayed by these fundamentalist religions? That's really what I want to know. And get away from all the debate we're having today on specifics of the laws of whether it's Sharia laws or Christian laws, whatever. Let's look at the big problem.
Can you say which bits of the world you think are more easily swayed?
Well, there are certain... I'm getting to dangerous grounds here. Some people are very easily emotionally swayed,
yeah.
and they can be swayed by fundamentalist teachings.
I think you've seen that in this country, haven't you, with people with mental disabilities of various kinds being swayed in ways that perhaps, if you like, somebody without that disability wouldn't.
Yeah, okay, if you look at the Western world, if you go back to it seems to me there's a certain racial makeup of the emotional makeup of people that get very, very caught up in arguments rather than being calm.
Would you like to try and answer the question rather than sort of...
No, the thing is I wanted to conclude what he was saying, just about the criteria.
There are quite a lot of other people and you have had a couple of goes, so... Can we bring some other people in? Is that possible? Maybe at the end? I'll try and bring you in before the end.
Thank you. Two points I wanted to make, just to our gentlemen, is that, first of all, it's less about fundamentalism and more about opportunism, in the sense that a lot of people, any religion, will be used to create an excuse for whatever human nature wants to allow, whether that's terrorism, violence in any sense, you'll just use Islam. In terms of why people seem to be swayed easily or why people are radicalised, speaking from the perspective of Muslim youth, if that's the case, from myself, I'm 23, one of the more talking about the point is that there are a lot of Muslims facing other social, economic issues, cultural issues hitting in the UK identity. I'm one of them. Obviously, I haven't been so swayed by radical ideology. But there are people who feel that they don't belong here, people who don't feel that they belong anywhere. Not back from India, Pakistan, wherever they may be from, and not here. The fact is that ISIS, Al-Qaeda, whatever group you want to name, they give you a sense of belonging, a sense of feeling like you are somewhere, that you can do something, you can make an impact. And that can be really hard for someone who's what, 16, 17. Perhaps you're not doing too well at school, perhaps your parents are pressuring you. And it's quite a trivial thing, actually. And at that age, you can't see what a big consequence it will actually come to be and who it will hurt, not just your family, but globally, the effect you're having and the organisation that you're joining. So I don't think it's as easy as saying, oh, well, Muslims are bad, this is bad. Because as a child, I was taught what Islam is. I'm a practicing Muslim. And so are all my friends, and all the people I know. And there's nothing in my religion that tells me that going out and doing this is okay. It's when you create circumstances for yourself, or that are created for you, that you find this path.
Can you Can you say anything about the prevalence in Cheltenham of people who want to radicalise young people? Is it a problem in Cheltenham?
I was just working there for 7 years at the Leeds College, just close by. And my school was very international. We had people from all over the world, different languages, religions. I had a fantastic time there. And I never felt like I had been targeted or anything by anybody who wants to either be racist towards me or radicalise me from both extremes. Only since referendum, actually, have I, walking around in this country, lost where I'm from. Have I faced people yelling at me on the street, even though I've lived here all my life. I wanted another 6 years to do my degree, do some new work, come back here, and now what I get from a lot of people is the fact that old Brown and everyone's living and saying that means possibly that he has something to do with terrorism. I share my last name with Saddam Hussein, so I got to use that at school as well. Just recently, last week, I went to Tesco late at night to get some food, and I was accosted by someone, so I get it, being a threat about the fact that I belong to ISIS and that Islam is about oppressing women. It's just not practical. And I don't think that in terms of what you said, sorry, that anyone radicalizing anybody, that it happens mostly online, which is where young people find this platform, Twitter, Tumblr, whatever you want to go to. And this is something that people of a certain age, older generation, don't have access to. And it's where people spend, young people spend most of their time in their bedrooms, just alone, where they are able to brainwash by this kind of stuff. And it's not singular to, you know, any particular thing, it's just where you find yourself at a certain moment in time and whether your mental state is such that you can kind of vulnerable to this.
Thank you, Chairman.
I'd like to argue in my defence that, not that I am a radical, but I have certainly been called such names by members of the media and so on. I'd say I'm not a liberal. I don't believe in liberalism as a political philosophy. I have criticisms against it. Many Christians and Jewish colleagues of mine also make criticisms against liberalism and communism and many other ideologies which we disagree with. But I'm certainly someone who at least esteems myself to be believing in the fundamentals of Islam, which were you know, based on classical Islamic understandings. So I don't come with any revisionist understanding of Islam. In fact, I always firmly root whatever I say in classical Islamic discourse and thinking for 1,200 years of it prior to colonialism. So this is why I say that. There is no different school of thought on the matter, on the issue of terrorism. There literally is no different opinion, no denomination that believes in an exemption to targeting civilians. And I'd just like to quote one classical Islamic scholar, because I've made some claims and I feel like I might need to justify these claims. So I'd like to quote a classical Islamic scholar called Imam Qurtubi, who was hundreds and hundreds of years ago. He wrote this very, very clear tract, and he said, "It is not permissible for us," referring to Muslims, "to retaliate in the same manner against an aggressor, even if they kill our women and children and cause sorrow to befall us. It is not permissible for us to act likewise with the intention of making them feel grief and sorrow." Now, I've got a whole bunch of other quotes here of other classical Islamic scholars. Classical thinkers were around the medieval period. This is where they kind of originate from. But time is short, I understand. But I'd like to highlight just one key issue. The cause of terrorism is not religion, and never has been. John Locke, a great European classical thinker, himself argued against this. He said that it's not religion that excites people to what he calls seditious action, but oppression. And this was his argument, because people were persecuting certain Christian sects around his time, and he was trying to say it's not their religion that makes them do it. It's because that's what the argument has been rehashed for centuries. It's their religion. It's those Protestants. It's those Catholics. It's those Jews. And now it's those Muslims. It's their religion that makes them do this. Or they believe this. Or they secretly hate the Goyim. Or they hate the non-Muslim. Or they hate the non-Catholic. This stuff, if you just look in history, it is, it's Groundhog Day. It's the repetition of the same stuff again and again throughout history. That's why human beings are so forgetful in looking at history. If you see it, the same arguments made against Catholics and made against Jews are now being made against Muslims. Criticizing the law they believe in. The law is barbaric. They hate non-believers. They are violent. They want to undermine our society here. The same arguments again and again. And I'd just like to draw your attention to, recently in America, I think it was 5 police officers were shot by people who were believed to be sympathizers to the Black Lives Matter movement. And this was after, I believe, 1 or 2African-American youngsters were shot by the police. And it's not. Is there any particular religion that African-Americans are following that makes them do this? No. What is it? It's a perception in their minds, in the minds of the criminals anyway, that there's an oppression going on, and that they got angry about it, and they retaliated in a criminal manner. And you'll see that repeated throughout history. Nelson Mandela's, the militant wing of the ANC, I think it was called the Umkhonto Sizwe, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, Spirit of the Nation, as it's translated. That was a militant wing. What most people don't realize, they were bombing shopping malls, restaurants, and cafes in South Africa. Nelson Mandela was called a terrorist, I believe, by Margaret Thatcher. Right? And though he was in prison, the government approached him and said, could you tell these people who are obviously your supporters, your subordinates, to stop doing this? And he said, well, when you stop your oppression of blacks in South Africa, I'll tell them to stop doing that. Most people don't realize that will happen. Does it justify that? Nope. In no way, shape, or form. All these examples are not justifications. They're just explaining, like any criminologist would be telling you, the causes of criminality. And that is what we have to look into. And it's got nothing to do with religious interpretation.
Thank you. Can I just go back to, I think, what my husband was asking, which is that instead of going through all this stuff over again, can we look at it from the point of view of we understand what happens, what has happened in the past, and what is happening now? And the point is, how do we stop it? Okay, so can I switch the conversation? Right, I'll keep going for a moment then. And a suggestion is that perhaps if we try and get the whole, this is going to sound very idealistic to you, the whole of the human race regarding each other as one family, instead of this group and that group and the other group and how this group is more important because they believe this, so this because they wear this. And, okay, so if we, and I simply throw this out there as a suggestion, to get past this problem that we can throw aspersions at every single group in history. But at some point we have to break the cycle. And I suggest that perhaps looking at the world as one country, at the human race as one family, and we educate children in this, we can start to get away from these awful outbreaks of hatred and violence, which the human race at the moment hasn't quite worked out what to do. Sorry, I just threw that in. I'm a Baha'i.
Thank you very much for that contribution. I think it is part of what Cheltenham Together is trying to do. That's why this group exists. So, madam.
Yes, I'm sorry, am I going to just respond very well? But basically, what I wanted to say, I came here to UK 5 years ago, and before that I didn't know anything about the Muslim. I'm Polish, and my daughter, she's half Polish, half Ethiopian, and so she, and I'm Catholic, so she has christening, but her father is Muslim. And since I'm here, I start to know more and more about the Muslim, and I heard a lot, and also the lady she mentioned before, my boyfriend Chris is from Africa, so from his family, I never heard anything bad, right, about the Muslim. So I know a lot of people, I know they are really good, they always say the Muslim is, you know, religion with full of love, but I heard a lot of about different Indian Muslim, Pakistani Muslim, Arabian Muslim, and to be honest, I'm so confused, because I would like to grow up my daughter with this both religion and explain to her what is good and where can I find that, what is the real, because you mentioned a lot about this fundamental Muslim, right? But at the moment, we hear a lot about this Islamic State and a lot of, you know, bad news. You open the Facebook every day and you just hear what the, you know, Muslim terrorists done. So how can I explain to my daughter what is the really fundamental Muslim which is good?
Thank you.
because I don't want to let her to, you know, okay, she's now Christian, but maybe in the future she will be Muslim, and I will not say to her, you know, you can't. And also the third, what he was mentioned before, I have a lot of friends who are homosexuals, so this is true that homosexuals can be Muslim too?
Anyone can be Muslim. Islam is just a belief, it's not a sexual preference. as for, well, maybe to advise your daughter, maybe not to go on Facebook. Probably I should take that advice too, actually. I'm also guilty of that. Unfortunately, social media, but not just social media generally, but I mean, many of the media sites, obviously, they show what sells, and what sells is the latest outrage by ISIS. But just look at the name ISIS. They were so, no one ever thinks, why do they call themselves?
Sorry,
a description.
I try to read about this a lot, but I want to find where can I read about the real fundamental Muslim. What in your opinion do really means this?
Well, when I refer to, let's say, Muslims who follow fundamentals, I don't refer to any particular school of thought per se. I refer to Muslims actually agree on much more than what we did when we disagree, and what we will see us arguing about is really small, obscure points of theology and so on. Islamic laws, ideas, how they're applied, praying and the rituals of praying are generally all the same. Everyone agrees on them. The mention about the prohibition against terrorism, there is no difference of opinion. There is no different sects that say, no, actually, I believe in exemption to that prohibition. No, everyone, Muslims generally follow a collected set of consensus beliefs that we all have a consensus in. And that's what I'm referring to as a quote-unquote fundamentalist. As distinct from a Muslim who I would call a modernist, which is Muslims who are to say, well, we're in the modern world today, so we can change a few things. We can imitate Western military history. We can do, change a few things in Islam to fit modern standards. But the problem is that modern standards might not be perfect, or might not be the best standards, perhaps.
Yes,
so that's what that my distinction.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, but for example, when you start to read about Islamic State, you find the information that the Islamic State went to back to the this what was on the beginning, like killing or, you know, different things. So where we can find the really true about that?
Oh,
so do you think the really Islamic
Are you trying
State?
To answer that?
Yeah, I want to answer
that. Could we let this lady have a go?
It's quite simple. If you want to learn about Islam, you go to the religious sources, the Quran and the Sunnah.
Okay. So for example, also, since I came here, I heard a lot about that. That is different translation, different language about the real Quran. This is true?
It's not significantly different.
They also heard that woman is not able to, they shouldn't read the Quran, just only the man.
I don't know where you heard that.
This is the thing. A lot of people, they heard something different.
You hear. It's all like kind of hearsay. You're saying you hear.
Yes.
Bring me the evidence from Quran and Sunnah, which says.
No, that I'm asking you. The
Quran and Sunnah. I'm telling you to go to Quran and Sunnah.
Okay.
And also Islamic lectures you can watch on YouTube. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is absolutely nonsense saying that women can't read the Quran. I'm sorry, but I don't know where they got that information from. And you know, maybe the media, like, there's a lot of propaganda and a lot of Islamophobia.
Yeah, I believe that. Of course, I believe.
Yeah.
That.
So, I mean, unfortunately, the media's throwing like a load of nonsense about Islam, a lot of misconceptions. And I used to be like, I really didn't like Islam. Okay, back in 2001, I hated Islam. Okay, I was like a hater. Yeah, but I studied Islam by myself. Yeah, because someone told me, pull yourself together. Islam's a beautiful religion. Study. So I studied, and I studied for 15 years. I self-taught myself, and I read Quran, Sunnah. There's a lovely film called The Message. That's a beautiful film. And I watched Islamic lectures, and I thought, oh my God, this media stuff is a load of nonsense. You know, especially about Islam, women's rights. Islam gave rights to women 1,500 years ago. Gosh, you know, it's, you know, the Muslim women are lucky.
If I might just quickly add to that, if you want to just have an idea of the rights to women that Islam gave, rights to own property. Obviously, they couldn't be chattel. They didn't adopt the surname of their husband. I think up to modern day West, it was only recent you got rid of couverture, the idea of the woman was basically kind of her properties didn't belong to her, belonged to her husband. That doesn't exist in Islam. A wife owns her property and she continues to own her property after divorce or before marriage or what have you. She can work. She can most definitely study. In fact, there's a great, interesting book which you can read called Muhaddathat, which is a study of the early Islamic scholars who were women. And the author went through up to about 5,000 to 6,000 Islamic scholars who were women during the first 300 years. He said he stopped at 6,000 because it would take too long. And so he just capped it at 6,000 and then published the book because it was just too many. So we didn't have any of these issues. And of course, everyone can access the Quran. In fact, we invite you. Quran is open source. Please read the Quran. And as for what she means by the Sunnah, she means the traditions or the sayings and the teachings and the actions of the Prophet Muhammad. So get it from the source yourself and judge for yourself whether X, Y, and Z groups are following that or not.
I'm going to bring in some people who haven't yet spoken. So this lady first.
Hi, it was actually directed towards yourself, but sorry, I didn't get your name.
My name's Olga.
Olga, hello. How old's your daughter?
She's 4.
Okay, so obviously she's 4 years old, so she's so young.
Yeah.
Obviously YouTube, media, probably the worst place for her. If you go just walk throughout town, particularly in Birmingham, there are always lots of people handing out free copies of the Quran, and it's generally easy just to get a source and then look up the translations yourself. But my main reason why I'm popping in is you mentioned that you had a few gay friends and that you put that question like, can you be gay and Muslim? Personally, I'm an atheist, so I look at all religion from like that sort of perspective, but I'm very interested in all religion. And I went to the march in Brighton this year, and obviously the beginning of the march, they were all holding up pictures of the people that were shot in the massacre in Orlando. So obviously that was quite a powerful thing, and then in the media in America they were saying, oh, this is a terrorist, and then a little while later they're like, oh, he was a Muslim terrorist. But then actually, halfway through the Pride, there was loads of gay Muslims marching, and it was really beautiful to see. And they weren't, you know, there was no abuse held at them for being Muslim, they were marching with their brothers and sisters in the spirit of like a togetherness. And there were gay Christians, gay Muslims, throughout the whole community, straight allies. And it was just really lovely to see, and I'd recommend anyone that's feeling like, oh, communities can't get along, maybe to attend a Pride, just as a straight ally, just to see. And it can open your eyes that how communities can actually get along, and it takes the hatred that we see in the media out of everything, just as a suggestion.
Thank you. So, you haven't spoken
yet. Can I just ask, following your comments, how does the burqa fit into that?
Well, the burqa is just an item of clothing. There's also the niqab, the hijab, and so on and so forth. But some Muslim women believe that to get closer to God, they want to adopt a form of modesty that is the niqab or the burqa, the complete covering. And if that's their Islamic opinion, then they have an Islamic right to adopt any Islamic opinion that they so choose as an act of piety. Many Muslim women choose not to adopt that Islamic opinion and just have the head covering for modesty.
So there's no coercion at all.
We're saying in Britain, and well, even a further afield in the Middle East and so on, there is no coercion I know of at all for wearing the burqa or the niqab. And the problem I think I find with that is this persistent idea that comes up in obviously the Western mind that it must be coercion. That if a woman isn't stripping off and donning all the latest makeup on her face and being showing as much flesh as possible, that she's somehow oppressed. I would argue, and many people do argue, that the opposite could be also true. That actually there is a type of social coercion for women to expose themselves, to put makeup on their face, and to the point that they have made many women to be frantically obsessed with how they look because they know that's how they'll be judged. And some Muslim women report that they wear the niqab as a form of freedom, in fact, from being judged by society. So, as I say, it depends your perspective and what you project onto others, but be careful not to project your own kind of perceptions onto other people, and they might be doing it for completely different reasons.
Okay, is there anybody who hasn't yet spoken since we're in the last bit? Yes.
Is that all?
Yeah.
So, I'm an atheist, but I'm not an atheist. I'm a Buddhist, but I'm not a Buddhist. I'm a Christian, but I'm not a Christian. And it goes on. And as I go on and I explore, I realize that I'm none of these things, but I'm all of these things. While I sit quietly through my life's journey, the ups and downs, I realize I'm a human being for the time being. But I'm left with this upset that I have as a human being. History shows us our upset. Until we understand that upset, we'll hide behind the Quran, we'll hide behind the Bible, we'll hide behind the Bhagavad Gita, we'll hide behind everything, and we'll blame everyone and everything until we give up that repetition and we realize what we come to realize. Beautiful words. Stop hiding behind the Quran. Stop hiding behind the Bible. Stop hiding and come out and show everyone how beautiful you are. Thank you.
Wendy.
Thank you. I mean, we've heard about how some twist Islamic texts to their own means. What I wanted to know is, how does Islamic law apply to the crimes of terrorists, and how might the concept of this mercy that you mentioned earlier be applied to these basically mass murderers?
Well, in terms of Islamic law, if someone has oppressed someone else or done a crime against somebody else, it's up for that person who's the victim to forgive or not. And while Islam generally encourages victims to forgive in the hope that God will forgive them their own personal failings, which is obviously also a Christian concept, if a state captures, obviously, terrorists, then Islamic law will deal with them as people who are, we have the concept called hiraba, which is like highway robbers or brigands and so on. They'll be obviously punished because of they've killed people. And obviously, you don't show mercy to people who are actively killing innocent people. Obviously, you fight them and punish them. So I don't think there's mercy will be shown to those who are actively killing people. But where mercy comes about in Islam is, for example, and this might be quite shocking, if someone commits an act of murder, the family of the deceased, the family of the victim, can choose to forgive the murderer. It's their discretion, and then the murderer has to pay them compensation, which has sometimes been translated as blood money, but compensation. But that's a choice they have in their hands. I remember a story in the news, it was a couple of years ago, of an Englishman. His daughter had been killed by an individual which the justice system failed to punish. And he actually pointed out that, he's not Muslim, but had it been under an Islamic government, he would have wanted that, because he would have wanted the choice to whether to punish that guy or not, and not that he would leave prison after how many, maybe a few decades, and he might kill again, for example. And he wanted that choice that Islam gives. Now, while in the British system you don't have death penalty, in America some states you do have the death penalty, but in the British system every murderer will be punished no matter what. There is no forgiveness for murderers at all whatsoever. Obviously, the judge might give a high sentence or a low sentence depending on the circumstance. But in Islam, that's where we talk about forgiveness. But it's up to the family of the victim to decide. But as for terrorists, they don't really murder one or two people. They murder quite a huge swathe of people, and they are actively doing it. So if they're ever caught, then they'll be punished, because they are like brigands or highway robbers. According from Islamic law's perspective, it doesn't give them mercy.
Nasser, I don't think you've spoken, so would you like to go next?
I just wanted to say, when you asked about how do I learn about true Islam, there are various sources, websites and videos that you can see on the internet. What I would say is
if you see anything or read anything and you think,
not sure is the book, if it doesn't feel right to you, then question it. Even if it is supposed to be from the Quran, even if it's supposed to be from the Bible, from the Sunnah, anything you read, just question it, and especially if it's anything to do with that's something you want to find out about. Don't accept the first thing that you read. Sarah asked, Sarah just there, you said we should all look at each other as family, and within Islam we have that concept where we all see each other as brothers and sisters, and our mother and father are Adam and Eve. So that is there fundamentally from the beginning when we're in Madrasa. That's
how it's all. Can I just say that my imam is here, he's just put his hand up with a white hat. Abdullah, behind you is another Abdullah. Some of the questions that I'll go and some of you guys put, he's a very learned guy who knows his stuff inside out. Okay. Have a word with him, grab him afterwards. And again, Sarah, I think humanity and getting back to, and this gentleman, what he said, getting back to the basics is very important. That's why I've set up a great local as a social enterprise, which is community regeneration, employment training and enterprise for young people to give them back to basics and give them an understanding of what we're about and how community cohesion can work together.
Okay, fantastic. I'm going to take two more contributions, one from this gentleman, last word for the lady at the end there.
Right, number one, the sir you were speaking about Muslim women being forced to wear a burqa or a headscarf, look at the Muslim woman behind you. And you have seen the diversity within Muslims. She's not wearing a headscarf, but she considers herself a practicing Muslim and she has a right to do so. This shows the diversity. We have other Muslim women wearing a headscarf. And myself, I am wearing something upon my head. My friends opposite aren't. This is the diversity of Islam. Number two, what Sarah was saying, there's actually a narration of the Prophet, peace be upon him. He says, Al-Khalq wa Iyalullah, that the creation, every single one of God's creation, are the family of God. And this is it. This is what Islam teaches. And okay, we will have differences, but differences will always exist. Like God says in the Quran, that some people will have different colors, different cultures, no problem. But in order for us to move forward, we are going to have some sort of, we're going to need some sort of medication that gives everybody a loss of memory about what happens. Because let's be honest, everything going on now doesn't start when somebody wakes up in the morning and thinks, you know what, I want to be a terrorist today. What has happened to a child or anybody growing up is I have seen my father killed in warfare. I have seen my mother killed in warfare. In order for us to move forward, we need on a mass scale, which is practically impossible, on a mass scale for all every single person to forget any hardship or hate they have suffered in their life. After you've done that, then you can look forward and say, you know what, now it's time to move forward. To expect everybody in the world to forgive one another after people in Serbia, Bosnia, people in Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, 1.5 million Iraqis were killed. How do you expect those children to forget families and villages being killed? And then you want them to stand up tomorrow and go, you know what, I want you to be an ambassador of peace. It's idealistic thinking, and I would encourage it as a Muslim, because that's what Islam says. Islam says, don't you want that God forgives you, that you forgive everybody else? So that would be idealistic. But let's be honest, if you've wiped out a whole village and one child survived, do you think that child isn't going to rise up against us? So in order for us to move forward, we need to make a way. Maybe it's impossible now because everything has gone on. But from now, again, it's up to the, in my opinion, everything that happens in the world is driven by power and money, selfishness and self-ego. If everybody, if every leader in the world looked at the benefit of humanity and not at the oil reserves of my country or the wealth reserves or the gold reserves of my country, then we would have a peaceful world. Until our leaders don't fix themselves, we can't really expect much to happen.
Thank you very much. Last word to you.
I'll try to keep it short. One thing I wanted to say about the book as well, and this is going to touch on what I was going to say earlier, which is that there's a lot of conflation happening between culture and religion, and how different countries, India, Pakistan, Saudi, whatever, practice the same religion. I feel like a lot of Muslim countries are not allowed to have a culture. We're not allowed to have a variation of interpretation in the way that we interpret Islam. It's meant to be a sort of uniform thing, which by human nature it cannot be. Of course you're going to have different interpretations of the same thing across such a subcontinent, even in one country. I think a lot of people claim the blame on Islam being that what you say is all the same, but actually this is happening. Because the culture exists, it's been happening for all time. The second thing that's all very nice, not to put down on the new thing, it's all very nice to sit here and say be idealistic, peace, and being an ambassador and everything's going to be great. the fact is there are issues going on, there are wars going on, and the media cycle is stuck on the fact that Muslims are failing them off. And this is going to continue for God knows how many years. And it's causing a really bad effect on the new generations, on the mental state of people of my age who are trying to grow up in this country. For example, you've got people in Paris who are my age who are Muslims, and they're struggling in slums. God knows how many years this politics is going to go on. And it's situations like this that are causing a return to such extreme activities. And we can't sit here and say, oh, well, politics can fix this. They've tried to fix it, nothing's happening. The fact is, it's an emotional and mental thing that can only be fixed when people are willing to admit that actions of some people in society are causing this. And we all want to be the first to stand up and say, oh no, we're doing the right thing, we're good people. When in actuality there are some people who are not, and we all have a share in this. So I think it's a case, yes, try and be a good person, but to try and admit that there are things that are going on that are bad from both sides, and that both of us just stand up and try and fix that.
Okay, thank you very much. It seems to me there's been a lot of very interesting contributions. We've learned a lot. I've learned a lot tonight. I hope you have. Seems to me more than that, there's been a lot of optimism. One might even say there's been a lot of love in this room. So I go away from here really buoyed up with the possibility that actually the world may be peace, more peaceful in time. But at the moment we see an awful lot of not very nice things out there. So thank you very much to all of you who made contributions and all of you who came along to listen. Particular thanks to Abdullah, of course, but I think you should give yourselves a round of applause. Please don't forget your feedback.